Friends, and welcome to the Tron Church for our evening service. We start with some words of the Apostle Paul from his letter to the Romans. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. Let's sing together. And our first song is about the church. Number 577 in our hymn books. The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. Number 577.
Thank you.
Well, let us bow our heads as we pray together now. And let's think of the Lord God, our Father in heaven, and our Lord Jesus Christ seated at his side in the heavenly places, looking upon our church and the church in the world, loving his people and seeking to bless them through their fellowship, through the preaching and teaching, the singing, through every means of grace. Paul writes in Ephesians, "And he gave the apostles and prophets, the evangelists, the pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children, tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness in deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow, so that it builds itself up in love." Our dear Heavenly Father, as we read these words of the Apostle Paul, given to him by the Holy Spirit, we rejoice in the church. We rejoice in this extraordinary institution, not man-made, but given by you and raised up by you. This outpost of the new birth, of the new creation, even in this old world, where the standards of the new creation begin to be practiced and understood and loved, even while we still rub shoulders with everything that is here that is disfigured and damaged by the sin of the human race. So we thank you that all over the world, at this very moment, there are congregations of Christians, large and small, who are meeting together and who are being built up through their fellowship and the teaching to mature manhood. Indeed, that something of the measure of the stature of Christ himself is being formed in your people. And because of that maturity, it's possible for us, dear Father, and we rejoice in this, that we may no longer be children, unaware of how to distinguish what is right from what is wrong, tossed to and fro by the waves, carried about by every wind of doctrine. We thank you so much that your words, your word, the Bible, is the means that you have given to us so that we should know it and love it, and learn therefore to understand your heart and mind, and be strengthened, to be unified, brought to the unity that is your will for your people. So we thank you so much. And we pray that here in our own congregation, this very evening, with speaking the truth in love, we might grow up in every way a little further into him who is the head, into Christ himself. Look down upon us, dear Father, in our immaturities and our pliancy, our ability to bend before the winds of doctrine and falsehood, and help us to grow stronger and firmer, that we might speak the truth in love to each other. And we thank you so much that it is Christ himself, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, that it's he who makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. Our prayer is therefore that your love and the love of Christ may be in our hearts this evening, and that you will help us to appreciate that love more and more tomorrow and Tuesday when we go back to work, when we get involved in other things. May the marks of Jesus be seen upon us. May the love that he has for us and that we have for him become increasingly obvious in the way we live our lives and the way we speak and relate to other people. Bless us, therefore, tonight. Build us up and encourage us. Help us especially, dear Father, at those points in our lives when we feel weak. Give us strength, more maturity, more understanding, we pray. And all these things we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, let's look up there just for a moment, friends. Very good to see you all here tonight. Welcome to everybody, old friends, new friends. And if it's your first time here, you're especially welcome. And do make sure you chat to one or two of the old faces. When I say old, I mean familiar faces, because it's a good way of learning to know people. One of the joys, in a sense, I was saying it in my prayer, but one of the joys of being here together is that we can help each other and help each other to grow in love for each other and to grow in strength in the Lord. So do let's take the opportunity at the end of the service to talk together and build each other up. There will be, I think, refreshments served both here and downstairs, so do stay and enjoy a refreshing drink as we talk together. Just one other thing to mention, prayer meeting this Wednesday night. Whatever else you've got on, don't take on any other engagements. Come to prayer meeting, 7:30, downstairs here. It's a most important time for us to be together to bring our thanks to the Lord, but also our requests for the work of the gospel. So do come if you can on Wednesday. Good, we're going to sing together again. The Lord alone, for God alone, my soul must wait in silence. From him alone shall my salvation come. A setting of Psalm 62.
Thank you.
Well, that's lovely to hear that singing. That one's getting into our system, isn't it? I don't know whether anybody else was listening to Radio 3 this afternoon when I was. A thing about Martin Luther. Now, was anybody? Ruth, were you listening to it? You're a muso. Were you not? Anyway, I'll tell you what it was about. Martin Luther. It's 500 years since he nailed his 95 theses up on the door of that church at Wittenberg, I think it was. So 500 years, 1517, he was at it. And there was quite a thing about Luther. It was very much, it was sympathetic to Luther. But one of the points that was being made was that Luther would take popular songs and set them to Bible words. He was a great musician, actually. He wasn't just a preacher and theologian. He was a musician, and he wrote words and music. But that has often been the case as the church has gone on. I wouldn't say this if Willie Philip were here, because, you know, it would swell his head. But he is very he's very good at this sort of thing, isn't he? Taking Bible words and setting them to a popular song. Who wrote that song a few years ago? Was it an Irish group? Yeah, anyway, that Irish group. So anybody else who's skilled in that sort of way, it is part of the way in which the Lord revives the church, actually, in producing new songs, scriptural songs, good songs, and to pick up secular tunes can be a really good way of doing it. Good. Now let's turn to 2 Peter after that outburst. It was just so lovely to hear you singing like that. Let's turn to 2 Peter chapter 2, which you'll find on page 1018 in our church Bibles. 2 Peter chapter 2. We were looking last week at the final section of chapter 1 when Peter is teaching his readers who to trust as their authority. And he was making the point that he and the other apostles, who were eyewitnesses of the majesty of Jesus, their words were to be trusted. But also, he says in verse 19 of chapter 1, we have something even more sure. That is the prophetic word of the Old Testament. So that's where the true teaching comes from, the apostles and the prophets. And he's going to bring in a great contrast, as you'll see here in chapter 2. So chapter 2, verse 1. But false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their sensuality or their pernicious teaching. And because of them, the way of truth will be blasphemed. And in their greed, they will exploit you with false words. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep. For if God did not spare angels when they sinned, but cast them into hell and committed them to chains of gloomy darkness to be kept until the judgment, if he did not spare the ancient world, but preserve Noah, a herald of righteousness, with seven others, when he brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly, if, by turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes, he condemned them to extinction, making them an example of what is going to happen to the ungodly, and if he rescued righteous Lot, greatly distressed by the sensual conduct of the wicked, for as that righteous man lived among them day after day, he was tormenting his righteous soul over their lawless deeds that he saw and heard. Then the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from trials and to keep the unrighteous under punishment until the day of judgment, and especially those who indulge in the lust of defiling passion and despise authority. Bold and willful, they do not tremble as they blaspheme the glorious ones, whereas angels, though greater in might and power, do not pronounce a blasphemous judgment against them before the Lord. But these, like irrational animals, creatures of instinct, born to be caught and destroyed, blaspheming about matters of which they are ignorant, will also be destroyed in their destruction, suffering wrong as the wage for their wrongdoing. They count it pleasure to revel in the daytime. They are blots and blemishes, reveling in their deceptions while they feast with you. They have eyes full of adultery, insatiable for sin. They entice unsteady souls. They have hearts trained in greed, accursed children. Forsaking the right way, they have gone astray. They have followed the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved gain from wrongdoing, but was rebuked for his own transgression. A speechless donkey spoke with a human voice and restrained the prophet's madness. These are waterless springs and mists driven by a storm. For them, the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved. For speaking loud boasts of folly, they entice by sensual passions of the flesh those who are barely escaping from those who live in error. They promise them freedom, but they themselves are slaves of corruption. For whatever overcomes a person, to that he is enslaved. For if, after they have escaped the defilements of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the last state has become worse for them than the first. For it would have been better for them never to have known the way of righteousness than after knowing it to turn back from the holy commandment delivered to them. What the true proverb says has happened to them. The dog returns to its own vomit, and the sow, after washing herself, returns to wallow in the mire. Amen. The word of the Lord, and may it be a blessing to us this evening. Well, let's turn now in our hymn books to a hymn about prayer. The people of God meeting together to pray. Number 609, Lord Jesus, when your people meet. Well, we'll have a short pause at this point as our offering for the Lord's work will be taken up. While the musicians play, you might like to look over that second chapter of 2 Peter again, try to get your mind around some of these rather difficult things. Let us pray again. And I'll read some words from the book of Revelation, which lift up our eyes beyond this world to the realities of the heavenly places and the throne of God. Then I looked, writes John, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads and myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, "To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might for ever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshipped. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, so much for this glimpse of the heavenly realities, where the throne which you yourself occupy is surrounded by myriads and myriads of angels and of the redeemed, those who belong to you. We thank you so much for that vision which the Apostle John has opened up to us by your grace. And we think there of the church finally, finally redeemed, finally brought to be with you, brought to your nearer presence, brought indeed so that we can see you and see the Lord Jesus, see him face to face, and come to understand more deeply and truly how much he has loved us, and you, dear Heavenly Father, how much your love has reached out to us to embrace us and to cleanse us and to make us fit finally to be with you. But here and now, dear Father, we know that we live in this interim period, saved and yet not finally saved. And our prayer is that you will help the churches to be strong, especially in the face of false teaching. We do ask that you will give to preachers and ministers and leaders courage, courage to teach the truth of the Bible fully, without fear. We pray too for those who write Christian books and ask that you will give them great skill, not only in teaching the truth of the Bible, but in seeing how it can apply and must apply to circumstances in this world, so that we can see how to engage with the world around us, how to speak to those who do not know you and perhaps are actively hostile towards you. Teach your church, we pray, to be more wise, more understanding. And our prayer, too, is for our own congregation, that you will keep far from our doors any kind of false influence and false teaching in the years to come, that you will strengthen our minister and elders and other leaders here and other teachers who teach in the different groups and Bible studies and so on. We do pray that you will help all who lead and teach to stick gladly to the Bible and to be built up by it. And tonight, dear Father, please speak to us, to our hearts and minds, through the words of the Apostle Peter, so that we too should be encouraged and strengthened. And we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, before we come to this passage from 2 Peter, we're going to sing together again. And this time it's number 558. O God, who shaped the starry skies and made the sun in splendor rise, whose love our life imparts, still may that same creative word, which formless void and darkness heard, be known within our hearts. Number 558. Well, let's turn again in our Bibles to 2 Peter chapter 2, page 1018. And my title this evening is Peter Warns the Church Against False Teaching. Now, as we turn to this second chapter in 2 Peter, I think we're all aware that it's a difficult chapter. And I guess that your heart may have been sinking slightly at the prospect of listening to a sermon on this chapter. I must confess that as I began my preparations a week or two ago to preach on this chapter, my own heart was rather heavy. I do remember doing some preaching from 2 Peter years ago to the congregation that I was serving at the time. And I remember giving them two or three sermons from chapter 1 and two or three sermons from chapter 3, but nothing from chapter 2. The fact was I chickened out. I didn't touch it. I found the prospect, quite honestly, too daunting. So I took the coward's way out and said nothing. But that won't do. That won't do, because God has put every chapter into the Bible for our instruction and ultimately for our comfort. And as we often say to our Cornhill students, there are no no-go areas in the Bible. So I'm having to eat my own words. The preacher is not at liberty to pick and choose. It's all here in the Bible to be opened up, and it all needs to be pressed into our understanding. But ultimately, of course, we shall be much stronger for it. Now, this chapter, above everything else, is a great warning to Christian people, a great warning to the church. We take our warning notices seriously when we're out of doors in the country. If you see a sign that says, danger, 30,000 volts, stay clear, you stay clear, don't you? Because the warning is there for your protection. And it's just the same with the warnings of the Bible. They're here for our protection, because the God who warns us is the God who loves us, and he warns us because he loves us. And the purpose of this chapter is to warn the church about the danger of false teaching and false teachers. Now, you'll see that Peter expresses himself very strongly here. There's a sense of crisis in the way that he writes. In this chapter, he's opening up to us a glimpse of the great warfare which continually exists in this world. And that is the warfare between truth and falsehood, which is also a warfare between wholesome living or godly living and immorality. Because truth, gospel truth, produces wholesome and godly living, whereas false teaching always issues in godless living and immorality. Now, one of the striking things about this chapter is just how long it is and how detailed it is. It's not enough for the apostle simply to say to us, beware false teaching. He develops his theme in a most determined way. He delves right back into ancient Bible history so as to show his readers the long roots, the historical roots of godless behavior. That's why he takes us right back to Noah in verse 5 and to Sodom and Gomorrah in verse 6, to Balaam the son of Beor in verse 15, whose story is told in the book of Numbers. And he quotes from the book of Proverbs in verse 22. So he's showing his readers that false teaching is not just a problem of the New Testament era, it has been around for millennia. It's one of the characteristics of the way that men and women rebel against God. Let me very quickly list for you the characteristics of false teaching that Peter describes here in this one chapter. These people are, verse 1, secretive. They teach heresy, verse 1. They deny Christ, verse 1. They deny the atonement, the master who bought them. They are given to sensuality in verse 2. They cause Christianity to be blasphemed, verse 2. They're greedy, verse 3. And that makes them exploitative, verse 3. They are ungodly, verse 6. Lawless, verse 8. They indulge defiling passions, verse 10. They despise authority, verse 10. They are bold, willful, and fearless, verse 10. And blasphemous, verse 10. They are irrational and ignorant, verse 12. They revel in daylight hours, verse 13. They are blots and blemishes, verse 13. Deceivers, verse 13. Adulterous, insatiable, greedy, and accursed, verse 14. They've gone astray, verse 15. They are springs and clouds that produce no water, verse 17. They're boastful, foolish, and sensual, verse 18. slaves of corruption, verse 19, entangled in defilements, verse 20, and finally, in verse 22, in moral terms, they lick up their own vomit and wallow in the mire. Well, that's all just from within this one chapter. Surely the apostle is meaning to shake us up and to shock us by describing these people in such gruesome detail. Now, don't forget that Jesus was equally detailed and vivid in his description of what comes out of the human heart. Like Peter, he didn't just say from within the human heart comes sin. He said, out of the heart of man come evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. The Apostle Paul, several times in his letters, produces similar lists of sins. Now, friends, let's thank God that the Bible is so detailed and thorough and insistent in describing the thoughts and actions and motivations of human beings when human beings go wrong. And if we ask, why all this detail? Why all this digging around in the vile swamps of the human heart? The answer must be that if we're left to our own devices, if we avoid reading this kind of chapter, we will never realize just how corrupt we are by nature and how much we need the gospel of salvation. If we're left to our own devices, we will think of ourselves as the world thinks. In other words, that we're all rather nice and kind, that no influence of teaching can possibly corrupt us, that the people described as false teachers in the Bible are nothing worse than colorful eccentrics or mavericks. But the Bible insists on going into these painful details at length in order to wake us up to the dangers that we're in, to the dangers that threaten the church and have threatened it from the time of Noah right down to the present day. Peter's message to his readers back then and to us today is take warning. We live in a situation of battle and warfare. The Christian life is very difficult. And if we're to survive intact, we must leave naivety behind. We must grow up into maturity and ensure that our churches are not invaded by the kind of evil teaching that will lead us astray. Now, the false teacher, as Peter makes it clear here in verse 1, is not an outsider. Peter says, there will be false teachers among you. In other words, it will be insiders, usually professing Christians, and quite often people who are acknowledged as leaders in congregations. Paul had said exactly the same thing back in Acts chapter 20 when he was speaking to the church elders at Ephesus. From among your own selves, he said, men will arise speaking twisted things. Dangers arise then within congregations, within denominations, within groups of churches. And today, of course, we have the added element of internet communication. You know how many churches, including our own, make their teaching sermons available online. So it's not as though a congregation is cocooned against the influences of other teachers from all over the world. We also have thousands of books available to us in a way that was simply not possible in the days of the apostles. Many of those books are a great blessing to us, but many of them can bring in false teaching. Well, let's turn now to the text. My plan is to spend 2 weeks, not just tonight, but 2 weeks in this chapter. This week, we'll look at some general principles that Peter is teaching about false teachers, and then next week, we'll get into some of the details a little bit more closely. So here's the first thing that we need to grasp. Peter is saying, learn discrimination. Learn to be discriminatory. We mustn't be squeamish. We mustn't say, for example, oh, I could never categorize Mr. So-and-so as a false teacher. If we're squeamish in that kind of way, we shall never grow up into maturity. Look at Peter's method here. He's presenting us with a great contrast between the true teacher and the false teacher. He's been describing the true teacher in the last paragraph of chapter 1. And we saw last week the true teacher, verses 16 to 18, are first of all the apostles who were eyewitnesses of Jesus, and secondly, in verses 19 to 21, the Old Testament prophets, whose teaching is true because they spoke from God, verse 21, as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. In short, then, the true teaching is the Old and New Testaments, the teaching of the prophets of old and the apostles of Jesus. But, chapter 2, verse 1, and here's the contrast, false prophets also arose among the people. That means the people of Israel in the Old Testament times. Just as there will be false teachers among you, among the Christian churches. So Peter, in the clear way in which he sets out his material, is discriminating between the true and the false. Now for us today, by what standard do we exercise discrimination? How can we tell whether a teacher who professes to be a Christian is a true teacher or a false teacher? Well, the answer is we must follow Peter's method. Peter is showing us that the teaching of the Old and New Testaments is the truth. So when we listen to a teacher, especially a teacher that we're not familiar with and therefore we haven't learned to trust, we have to ask if his teaching accords with the teaching of the Old and New Testaments. We ask, what is this man's attitude to the Bible? Does his teaching show clear signs of glad submission to the Bible, or does he give the impression of being superior to the Bible, as if he knows rather better than the apostles and the prophets? Now, I'm well aware that it's not easy sometimes to exercise this kind of necessary discrimination, and it's certainly unwise to be in too much of a hurry to categorize somebody as a false teacher. For example, at our Cornhill training course, we listen to practice sermons every week from our students, two or three or four sermons. Some of the practice sermons are very good and are a joy to listen to, but sometimes a student misses the mark rather badly and gets the wrong end of the stick in teaching a passage. Now, when that happens, does the tutor say, well, you'll have to leave the Cornhill training course today, you're obviously a false teacher? Well, of course not, of course not. The tutor points out where the sermon has gone wrong, and then the tutor and the student and the rest of the class all work together so as to understand the passage more accurately. That's how teaching takes place. It's how learning develops. We make mistakes, we learn from the mistakes, and then we make progress to a better understanding of what the Bible is saying. In the same way, we recognize that two teachers who are both fundamentally true teachers of the Bible may differ on certain secondary points. For example, one teacher believes that the Bible supports the position that only adults should be baptized. Another teacher believes that young children of Christian parents should properly and rightly be baptized. But those two teachers don't think of each other as false teachers. Each thinks of the other as a true teacher who is truly submitted to the Bible's authority, but who takes a different view on a secondary issue. So let's not be hasty to brand people as false teachers. The way Peter describes false teachers in this passage reveals a very different type of person, a person with a fundamental commitment to ungodliness and immorality. So friends, we mustn't be afraid to be discriminating. Peter is teaching us to discern, to be willing to say, this is true, but this is false. That's a big part of Christian maturity, to be able to say, this is true, this is false. However, we live today in an age that is not favorable to discriminatory talk. One of the great features of the modern Western world is its unwillingness to say that anything is wrong. I remember being at a conference of Christian ministers some 25 years ago, where one of the main speakers was a fine pastor from Los Angeles called John MacArthur. And John MacArthur said to this gathering of ministers, "There has never been an age before now in which Christian ministers have shown such inability to exercise discrimination." Christian ministers. I can tell you that comment sunk into my soul. Unwillingness to exercise discrimination will eventually lead to incapacity to exercise discrimination. The lines become blurred in a person's thinking until there are simply no lines left. But the very essence of the Bible is to draw lines between truth and falsehood at every turn. Almost everything the Bible says involves drawing lines. Just think of the first verse of the Bible. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now that verse is drawing sharp lines between truth and falsehood at several points. That verse is saying, no, you're wrong, first, to the person who denies the existence of God. In the beginning, God. Secondly, to the person who says that the universe came into being in a random and unaccountable way. That's what so many people think these days. And thirdly, to the person who says that human life on planet Earth cannot possibly have any meaning. The whole Bible presents us with a contrast between what is true about God and what is false about God. So Peter's second letter is just one passage amongst hundreds where the true and the false are being starkly contrasted. Our problem today is that the nature of society makes us fearful of drawing lines between the true and the false. We can become fearful for our very safety. Just think of the great issues which the church is having to face today. There's the issue of the truth of Christianity over against the falsehood of other religions. There's the issue of salvation and judgment, the reality of condemnation and hell for those who refuse to bow to Christ. And particularly today, there's the issue of homosexuality and transgenderism. Now, a church leader today can be cowed into silence because he fears that if he teaches the Bible's teaching about these things, he might get a brick put through his window or a hate-filled antagonist who might search him out and kill him with a knife or a rifle. So he says to himself, I'd better keep quiet about those things. Fear stops him from teaching the truth of the Bible. He's afraid to be discriminatory, so he stops teaching the truth. Peter never stopped, did he? And what happened to him? He was crucified in Rome. Paul never stopped. And what happened to him? Beheaded in Rome. Jesus never stopped, and we know what happened to him. It's no wonder that Jesus said, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross. That means prepare to die and follow me. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was put to death just before the end of the Second World War, used to say, when Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. To hold the Bible's distinctions between the true and the false will inevitably lead some Christians to an early grave. So there's the first thing. Peter shows us by his example that we need to discriminate. Now, second, Peter shows us that false teaching is initially hard to detect. Look at verse 1. There will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies. J.B. Phillips translates it, they will be men who will subtly introduce dangerous heresies. Secretive and subtle, not obvious. So these people will not be wearing a big badge on their coat that says, I am a false teacher. They will put themselves forward as true teachers. Jesus makes exactly the same point when he says, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. If the wolf came in wolf's clothing, we'd immediately recognize him, but he comes like a sheep. It's only later on that the fruits of his influence become obvious. Jesus goes on, by their fruits you will recognize them. But it can take some time before the fruits of their influence appear, because initially they can look good and true. Their false teaching is secretive and subtle, not obvious. Let me give some examples of how false teaching can be hard to detect. It can be presented as something exciting and new. It's often described as a new wave. Whenever you hear that phrase, be suspicious. New waves usually turn out to be old fallacies. Some of you may remember something called the Toronto Blessing, which took place about 30 years or so ago. What happened there was that there were various churches in the city of Toronto in Canada who became excited by what they reckoned were manifestations of the Holy Spirit. People started falling over in church services. Some of them were roaring like lions and braying like donkeys. Now, I knew a number of pastors in England who actually got into an aeroplane and went across to Toronto to spend a week or two there to observe all this so that somehow they could bottle it up and bring it back to their own churches. But it was a silly excitement which did nothing to promote serious evangelism or godly living. It was patently nonsense. Then some years later, when I was at Burton-on-Trent, one or two of the local churches there had people who were claiming that their teeth were being miraculously adorned with gold fillings. Did you have that in Glasgow? Gold fillings in the teeth? Come and look at my teeth, they said, and you'll see the power of God. Now, it was absurd, of course. The problem is that some people really believed it and got very excited about it. But a person who builds their faith on that kind of nonsense rather than on the Bible is likely to crash and burn as a Christian. So we mustn't be gullible and think that a thing is true because it's new. Then secondly, a false teaching can be hard to detect because it's popular. People can feel that because something has the weight of popular opinion behind it, it must be right. It's a kind of democracy gone to seed. Look at our verse 2, because we see it here. Many will follow their sensuality. That word sensuality could be translated their pernicious teaching. Many will lap up the falsehood. One of the great falsehoods of the last 150 years or so in the Western world is the idea that the Bible can no longer be really trusted as being true, that it's a collection of cleverly devised myths, that it's fairy stories or moral fables. That's the way the man in the street will often think of the Bible. So people say, no one seriously believes the Bible in our modern day. Certainly no cultured or educated person believes it. And if you listen to a radio program like The Moral Maze on Radio 4, where current moral problems in society are discussed, if anyone tries to bring in the Bible as a serious contributor to ethical discussion, it gets dismissed very quickly and often contemptuously. The Bible, my dear, so old-fashioned. Who wants to take us back to the morals of the 18th century? Now look on down our page in chapter 2. Peter writes here about Noah in verse 5. I'm thinking of popular pressure here. Peter describes Noah as a herald or preacher of righteousness. Now think of the way that Noah preached righteousness. He was building a huge boat miles from the sea in a sun-scorched desert. And presumably as he built, he was telling his neighbors and contemporaries that the reason for this ark was that a judgment by flood was coming soon. But nobody repented. The weight of popular opinion was entirely against him. But the world that refused to believe his message perished. The weight of popular opinion was against him, but he was right. He was vindicated. Then look at the next verse, verse 6. The whole population of Sodom and Gomorrah was turned to ashes, and only Lot and his daughters were rescued. They put their trust in the Lord and obeyed his command to leave the place. But the whole of popular opinion was against them. And it's this pressure of popular opinion which can intimidate a Christian leader into submission. I was listening not many weeks ago to a recorded sermon from a pastor in the south of England. He was the senior pastor of a congregation down there. And in the course of his sermon, he said this to his congregation. I've agonized over this now for some years, but at last I've changed my mind on homosexuality. I now believe that it's right and proper for love to be expressed physically in same-sex relationships. And he was inviting his congregation, of course, to follow his lead. And I realized as I listened to this recording that I was listening to a man who had become a false teacher. He'd given way to the pressure of popular opinion. He'd reached a point where he said, because the majority now seem to believe this, it must be right. So first, we need to discriminate. Second, we must recognize that false teaching can be hard to detect. And third, we must recognize the connection between false teaching and immorality, immoral behavior. Look again at our chapter. Verse 2, sensuality. Verse 6, the sins of Sodom and Gomorrah. If you read the account in Genesis 19, you'll see that the men of Sodom were involved in homosexual gang rape. Peter describes it in verse 7 as the sensual conduct of the wicked. Then look on to verse 10, the lust of defiling passion. Verse 14, eyes full of adultery, insatiable for sin. And then verse 18, sensual passions of the flesh. So false teaching is never just about errors in our thinking and our understanding. But here's the key question. Is it false teaching that produces immoral living, or is it the desire to live immorally that produces the false teaching? Now surely it works both ways. Look at verse 2. Peter says, many will follow their sensuality. Now why is it then that so many are so ready to listen to false teaching? Why is it that if some clergyman, some minister, puts forward a new theory that undermines the Bible's truthfulness, why is it that so many people follow him so readily? Why do people lap up completely unsustainable ideas, such as the idea that Jesus had an affair with Mary Magdalene, or that David and Jonathan were homosexual lovers? Why do people love to believe the clergyman who preaches that everything miraculous, everything supernatural in the Bible could not possibly have happened? There's only one answer to those questions, and that is that the false teaching makes it easier for them to live the kind of life that they want to live. If they can say, but the Bible is not true, and God is not as the Bible makes him out to be, the next step is to say, I don't need to regard myself any longer as accountable to God. I can live as I please and no longer be troubled by my conscience. There's a good example of this in George Gershwin's famous musical, Porgy and Bess. Gershwin was a very talented American composer who was writing towards the middle of the 20th century. And he produced this musical show about a poor black man called Porgy who falls in love with Bess. That's a rather touching story, and it has some great music in it. But one of the songs is called It Ain't Necessarily So. Hands up if you know that song, It Ain't Necessarily So. Okay, quite a few of you have heard it. All right, do you know what it's about then? The strap line goes like this. The things you are liable to read in the Bible, they ain't necessarily so. And here's one of the verses. Now Jonah, he lived in a whale. Yes, Jonah, he lived in a whale. Now he made his home in that fish's abdomen. Yes, Jonah, he lived in a whale. And then immediately the chorus strikes up. It ain't necessarily so. Now on the level of music, it's great jazz. But on the level of truth, it is Bible denial. It's false teaching. And popular music is one of the channels by which falsehood is pumped into the bloodstream of society. Now, I don't mean that all popular music is bad, not at all, but it's one of the doorways through which ideas that hold God in contempt can enter the shared understanding of a culture. There is something in the nature of man that wants to believe that the Bible's account of God is not true. Because if we can dispense with the God who calls man to account, the God who defines sin and holiness, we start to believe that we can get away with immoral behavior. The twisted heart of man will welcome false teaching because it excuses the way sinful man wants to live. Now, let me just take one example, and I come back to this because it's such a pressing thing today, and so many of our younger people haven't really understood this yet. Numbers of books and articles have been produced in recent years arguing that the Bible does not say that all homosexual activity is sinful. These books ask us to believe that the Bible's prohibitions were culturally conditioned, applicable and appropriate perhaps in Jewish society back then, in the time of Moses, or perhaps in the first century AD, at a time when Christianity was newborn and needing to define itself as a new force in the pagan world. But cultural conditions have changed, we're told, and we ought now to accept and welcome same-sex relationships of a loving, committed, and permanent nature. Now, you can only read the Bible's teaching on homosexuality that way if you have a prior pre-commitment to the conclusion that you want to reach. You couldn't possibly reach those conclusions if you read the Old and New Testaments honestly. The Old and New Testaments consistently, unambiguously condemn all homosexual activity as sinful. I was talking with an old friend of mine down in England a few weeks ago, a man who has a very good mind and is a very able writer. And he told me that he's working at the moment on producing a 500-page book in which he is seeking to demolish comprehensively the kind of false teaching on homosexuality which I've just been describing. I was very chuffed to hear that. I'm so glad that my friend, who's very able, is tackling this subject. And we need to pray for all such people that their ability as writers will be harnessed by the Lord for the demolition of false arguments and thus for the strengthening of ordinary Christians and ordinary churches. Well, friends, we'll delve further into the details of this chapter 2 next week, but let me finish this evening with a couple of practical hints and suggestions arising from all this. First, we must expect the Lord's church to be frequently bombarded by false teaching, because the devil never goes on vacation. He's always looking for ways of undermining Christian morale and confidence in the Bible. Peter says, do you remember back in his first letter, resist the devil, firm in your faith. One way of resisting him is by frequently encouraging each other to live the Christian life wholeheartedly and full-bloodedly, because false teaching will always encourage us to be disobedient, not only in sexual morality, but in 100 other ways. Therefore, the kind of encouragement that we can give each other will very often be encouragement to be obedient. It may not seem like that always, but that's what lies behind it. Obedience to the Lord brings blessing and happiness, whereas disobedience to the Lord brings disaster and misery. That's one of the Bible's constantly stated themes, and we know it's true. So we have a responsibility towards each other to keep each other on what Jesus calls the narrow path that leads to life. But we need to be constantly encouraging each other, because false teaching is in the very atmosphere that we breathe. It's everywhere. It comes to us through the airwaves, on the radio and television, on the internet. It seeps into our systems like fog seeping into a barn. But we must expect it, because as Peter says here in verse 1, there will be false teachers among you. There will be. Then secondly, without becoming obsessed with false teaching, let's listen out for it. Let's develop a nose that is able to smell it. I sometimes encourage our Cornhill students to listen to the religious broadcasting on Radio 4. And some of them look at me as if no sane being could possibly be interested in listening to Radio 4. But I do encourage them to do that, because I want them to know what's being said out there publicly in the name of Christianity. And I particularly remind them of Thought for the Day, weekdays at 7:45, and the Sunday morning service, which runs from 8:10 till 9:15 every Sunday. Now, sometimes you hear excellent talk, excellent speaking that really does express the Bible's teaching. But that is the exception rather than the rule. The majority of what you hear arises from a way of thinking that rejects the Bible's teaching on salvation and judgment, rejects the Bible's teaching on sin and holiness, and rejects the teaching on the cross as the place where Jesus bore the penalty for our sins and propitiated the wrath of God. But let me encourage all of us to develop an awareness of what is being said out there in public places and in many churches, in the name of Christianity, but not according to the Bible's teaching. Now, as I say, I don't mean that we should become obsessed with false teaching, like theological bloodhounds baying for their prey. It is possible to become a hard-faced Christian who's always condemning other people. You've seen that, haven't you? Let's not be like that. We are, above all, good news people, people who pass on the glad tidings of a wonderful Savior. As the old hymn puts it, we have a gospel to proclaim, good news to men on all the earth. So of all people, it's Christian people who know how to smile and who know how to laugh, not with the world's empty cackling laughter, but with the joy that our sins are forgiven and the gates of heaven are open to those who belong to Christ. But let's follow the example of the apostles and of Jesus himself, teaching the good news and drawing out its implications, pressing home how good and delightful it is, but also because we love the church, because we care about the state of the health of the church, understanding false teaching and how much damage it can do. It dogged the heels of the New Testament churches, and it will dog the heels of the Lord's church until the Lord returns. It is part of the landscape. So let's take to heart this great chapter of warning, remembering the bitter outcome of false teaching. For as Peter says in verse 1, there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. That's the reality. The bitter end of it all is destruction. So let's keep to the teaching of the prophets and the apostles. To hold to the good news involves continually distinguishing it from false teaching. But it's the good news which brings joy to the Christian heart. And it's sticking to the truth of the Bible that characterizes those who truly belong to the Lord Jesus. Let's bow our heads and we'll pray. We thank you, our gracious God, for putting these words into the heart and mind of your servant, Peter. Thank you so much for his clarity and determination and insistence about these things. And we do pray that you'll help us to have something of his own spirit, that you'll help us to be willing to stick with the Bible, to stick with the apostles and prophets, to love them, to love the good news and to live by it, and to encourage each other to be obedient, because we know that's what pleases you. So have mercy upon us all, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, for our last hymn now, let's turn to number 890. Stand up for Jesus. It can be quite challenging to stand for him, can't it? But that's an encouragement from George Duffield, the writer, 19th century hymn writer. Stand up for Jesus, number 890.
Thank you.
as we stand, some words from Revelation chapter 1. Now to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom, priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen.